Happy birthday, church. Welcome to Pentecost Sunday. The colors of Pentecost are red, so hopefully you are wearing red while you're watching this morning and while we are worshiping. Red is symbolic of the tongues of fire that came to light on the apostles. This is the day when we remember God poured out his Holy Spirit on all believers. And Peter, we call it the birthday of the church because Peter, empowered by the Spirit, and the folks listening, empowered by the Spirit, came to be saved. Over 3,000 people. So this is really the first sermon after the ascension. And 3,000 people were saved. And then it says that the Lord added daily to their numbers those who were being saved. So happy birthday, church. Pentecost is the Sunday of power. And so it's, I think, appropriate for me to read a disclaimer that I have had in the bulletin every once in a while. It's a warning. Enter into the presence of the Lord at your own risk. Spending time with Jesus can be risky business. He might call you out of your comfy pew and turn your world upside down. This hour belongs to Jesus. So please check your inhibitions and perceptions of what church ought to be at the door and get ready to worship God. Come to Jesus, you who are thirsty. Drink deeply of the Holy Spirit. Let your heart overflow with the living water that renews the face of the earth. Let us worship God. I invite you to join together and sing Every Time I Feel the Spirit.
Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Upon the mountain when my God spoke, out of his mouth came fire and smoke. I looked around me and looked so fine. I asked my Lord if all this was mine. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. There ain't but one train running on this track. It runs to heaven and it runs right back. If I behave, they will let me ride. I'll have a home there when I get inside. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. I will pray.
Let us pray. God of wind, word, and fire, we bless your name this day for sending the light and strength of your Holy Spirit. We give you thanks for all the gifts, great and small, that you have poured out upon your children. Accept us with our gifts to be living praise and witness to your love throughout all the earth. Through Jesus Christ, who lives with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. My grandmother described the Grand Canyon like this: John, it's just a big hole in the ground. Gladys Jones was not very impressed. I spent the summer of 1981 at the north rim of the canyon, and I hiked the canyon several times, and it's very hot. The heat of the sun bakes the canyon walls. I descended deeper into ancient geological time, step by step, layer by layer. I imagined it akin to marching down to hell itself. It was that hot. I would watch for rattlesnakes in the drainage ditches, the offspring of the serpent from the garden, dwarfed by the growing canyon walls above and below. Heat sapping strength from my body, one wrong step plummeting me almost endlessly to the final slamming of my death. I have never felt so small and vulnerable. We build rockets that deny the natural law of gravity, thrusting people into space. We can build magnificent machines to keep us living when our lungs or heart stop functioning. But these things do not exist in the Grand Canyon. When it's just a person with a backpack and a canteen, you are left at the mercy of something bigger and more wonderful and terrible than yourself. At the speed of thought, the mind rockets toward infinity and possibility. I remember sitting several times on the edge of the Grand Canyon, looking down into that vast emptiness, and then down into, you know, down and down and down. And I was wrestling in my mind between fight and flight, and there was part of me that just wanted to jump off the canyon rim. That was my mind, thinking I could float forever. What a wonderful experience that would be. But the body understood the sudden slam at the end. And so the body would say, "Get back! Get back!" This conversation between the body and the mind. While hiking, my body would say to me, "Stay away from the edge. Watch where you're walking. You know, you need to drink more water. Don't you think we should turn back now?" In her essay entitled Eclipse, Annie Dillard writes of this struggle between the mind and the body. And in my opinion, she laments the shallow victory of the body. The mind wants to live forever, or to learn a very good reason why not. The mind wants to know all the world and all eternity and God. The mind's sidekick, however, will settle for two eggs over easy. The dear, stupid body is as easily satisfied as a spaniel. And incredibly, the simple spaniel can lure the brawling mind to its dish. I've hiked three times from the North Rim, and only once did the journey end with me not suffering from dehydration and heat exhaustion. Almost 40 years later, I now take the hike through the safety of my couch and YouTube. My body has once again plopped me into my comfort zone. You know, we talk about the power of mind over matter, but I have a hunch that we'd much prefer matter. The story of Pentecost starts in the comfort of company and familiar surroundings. They were all together in one place, in a house, perhaps not unlike their hiding place on that resurrection day, safe together once again, trying to figure out the next step, waiting and wondering. And then suddenly, right between the second and third cups of coffee, the spirit blows of violence into the huddled few. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. Perhaps their experience was something like this. Violent wind but flames at rest. At rest, they do not devour. Quite a contradiction, like a funnel cloud and a rainbow. Like the fascinating, terrible, timeless imaginings and the comfort of macaroni and cheese. Mind and body, unlimited and structure, risk and security. And then the most amazing but awful thing happens to them. Luke records, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. Here they were, doing 24/7 the way they always did, hanging out on a couch. And then God comes along in a very violent way. The power of a mighty rushing wind, the comfort and the warmth of tongues of fire. Speaking languages they never learned, they leave the house and spill out onto the street. People who hear them are bewildered, confused, amazed. What is this? How did these Galileans learn all of these languages? They're just fishermen, common folk. The crowd quickly retreats from the mysterious and horrible possibility. This may be a God thing, to a senseless but familiar explanation. They must be drunk. This is something they can understand. This is something they can get their heads around. This is something that's measurable, something they can control, something that is safe. And then Peter speaks both the terrible and comforting news. He reminds them that this shouldn't be a surprise, that this was forecast long ago through the prophets. And he remembers what they wrote and speaks it to them. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. When Peter finishes with an altar call, around 3,000 people respond. Luke records it. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. We need Pentecost to remind us that it's not about what color to paint the church door, or whether to buy pew cushions or carpeting, whether to pay for the youth group's pizza party. We need Pentecost to remind us that God's not always interested in safe places and comfort zones. We need reminding just what we're dealing with, or rather, who is dealing with us. Annie Dillard, in her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk, Expeditions and Encounters, writes, why do people in church seem like cheerful, brainless tourists on a package tour of the absolute? Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we blithely invoke. Or as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? The churches, our children playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill a Sunday morning. It is madness to wear ladies' straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God may wake someday and take offense. Or the waking God may draw us to where we can never return. Pentecost, the feast of the powerful, the feast of power. Pentecost is a day to release the mind from the body's grasp, to release risk from comfort, to implore the Spirit once again to burn and to blaze and to create anew. Let us join together as we sing, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Place, Spirit, place. Set our hearts. Shadows into your radius. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Shine, Jesus, shine.
with grace and mercy send forth your word, Lord, and let it light. Let it be
Receive the benediction. Following Jesus isn't safe, but the reward is worth the risk. Release your mind to wonder and wander. Dream God's dreams. Seek God's visions. Let the Spirit burn and melt, that God may mold you, that God may mold us. Go and keep in step with the Spirit. And watch your feet tread, perhaps on dangerous but holy ground. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you and keep you.